Welcome to Algorithms 2, the chapter on external memory algorithms. So our last chapter was relatively short because the randomized algorithms chapter only gave a few examples, whereas other examples are spread all over this lecture. The chapter on randomized algorithm was centered around a methodology for designing algorithms. Now we have our first chapter on a machine model, namely the external memory model for designing algorithms that can handle large data sets and memory hierarchies. So the model that we will use in most of this lecture is very simple. We basically have a standard von Neumann machine, sequential processor with registers and an arithmetical logical unit that can process word-sized elements in constant time and a fast, freely accessible memory. But the difference to the von Neumann model is that this fast memory has a limited size, and there's a size parameter m defining this. And the remaining data is stored in a large memory, and we are constrained to access a large memory in blocks of size b words. And now, of course, accessing such a large block will take much longer than accessing a single word here, usually more than b times the time for accessing a single word in the fast model. So we have to be really careful with the number of block accesses, or this is also called IOs, that are done. Thus, in algorithm theory, usually external memory algorithms, they just count the number of block accesses. In algorithm engineering, we additionally do an analysis of the internal running time, because that is also often a bottleneck of an algorithm. So let's first look at a simple example, a stack data structure. What we are doing is we basically have a file consisting of data blocks, and we keep two internal buffers in the fast memory. And we have to support the two operations push and pop, right? Okay, and the operations work like this. So a push operation writes into the buffer. So this is this top of stack pointer. And the red stuff is data that is there, and the white stuff is free. And then as long as there's space, of course, we can just push data on the stack. Now, when both of these buffer blocks are full, we are writing out this block one, and then block two becomes the new block one. And we could actually copy the data back here, but that causes a lot of internal work. We basically swap the identity of these blocks. And by the way, that's one of the things in algorithm engineering for external memory algorithms. You have to be very careful about copying around a lot of data, because that can also be a bottleneck. As an exercise, perhaps think about whether you could implement the stack data structure also with a single buffer block, or what may go wrong. Maybe there are operation sequences where you have a lot of IOs compared to the number of operations. Okay, how does a pop work? It's the same thing, right? As long as we can answer a pop locally, we do that. And it may happen that the buffers run entirely empty. Then what we do is that we pop one block from the external part of the stack. Yes. Okay, so that was just a warm-up, and I will now spend a little bit more time explaining how to do external memory sorting. And that also turns out to be a key part of building many further algorithms, because sorting basically puts things together in an order you want to process them, and that is a pattern for doing many things also in external memory. So now we want to sort n elements in the external memory model. So I will first explain binary merge sort in a formulation that is well suited for an external memory implementation. For that, we need an external memory binary merging routine. And that's this procedure here. It gets three files as input, two files A and B that should be merged, and file C that should get the sorted sequence of output elements. So you can visualize the state of this algorithm like this. Actually, any reasonable implementation of a file system will basically implement this part of the algorithm for you, that when you open a file, it has at least one buffer block where it buffers the stuff that's currently being read, right? The same thing for writing. So that's all internal to the file system or the runtime systems part of this, right? What you do is within these buffers, you have a current element. So you read the next elements into the variables x and y and compare them. And since each of these sequences is sorted, the globally smallest element that is not yet processed is a minimum of x and y. So you choose this minimum and write it to the output, which also has a buffer block. And then, of course, if the buffer is full, it performs an IO operation and thus empties the buffer. Similarly, when you read an element from a file and the buffer block gets empty, then the next block from the sequence will be read. Right? So if we have chosen the smaller element, we output it to C and read the next element from the right sequence. So that's the pseudocode for it. We initialize x and y by reading the first element. Overall, we have a size of a plus size of b iterations. If the smaller element comes from sequence a, then we write x and reread x from sequence a. Otherwise, we write y and reread y from sequence b. And it's not easy, not difficult to see that this is a correct merging algorithm, and that the number of IOs we need is something size of a plus size of b divided by capital B IOs for reading. There may be some rounding issues, so that we may have one additional block read for A and B, and then we are writing size of A plus size of B elements also. So overall, there's two times size of A plus size of B divided by B IOs, perhaps plus three. And for this to work, we need three buffer blocks available, and that implies that we need that the size of the fast memory M must be larger than 3 times B. So in order to construct a full-fledged sorting algorithm out of this, we use an additional component, a kind of base case that should be as big as possible in order to save on IOs. Basically, what we do is we do something that's called run formation. We load chunks of data into the fast memory. It will have size about m, right? Sort it internally and write it out. Then this is the first run, second run, third run, and so on. So this will read all the data once, it will write all the data once, so it takes 2n over b IOs for sorting n elements. So out of this we can build a binary merge sort algorithm. We first run run formation, and then we iteratively merge pairs of runs until there's only one run left. So here's an example, sorting the characters and make things as simple as possible, but no simpler. But I think this is sometimes attributed saying to Albert Einstein. And then the form runs will sort the characters in each of these four parts. So say that that's the maximum number of elements fitting into fast memory. Then we merge two of these sequences, another two in the first pass, and then we merge the remaining two, and we are done. So run formation will take 2n over b IOs. Merging, well, there was a lot of calculating around the size of the two inputs. But the nice thing about this binary merge sort algorithm is that the run sizes are always about the same up to rounding. And that in each pass, we are basically reading everything and writing everything. So in each iteration of this main loop, we will have 2n over b IOs. So 2n over b for run formation and 2n over b for each iteration. So how many iterations are there? It's easy to show that this is log n over m rounded up. So overall, the number of IOs is 2n over b times 1 plus log n over m rounded up. So let's do a sample calculation with an input that's a terabyte large, a machine that has 16 gigabytes of RAM. So that's a medium PC as you may have it at home, and say a block size of 4 megabytes, that would be typical for a modern mechanical hard disk. And say we need 1/16 of a second for an IO, which is also corresponds about to the bandwidth of a modern mechanical hard disk. Then if I set in all these values, I get something like 2 to the 16 seconds, which is 32 hours, which basically tells you, well, you can sort a terabyte of data, so that would also be about maybe half the capacity of your hard disk, right? The other half you need because it's not an in-place algorithm. You can do it in 1.5 days, and you could say, well, that's maybe for most applications too slow. But I will now show you how to reduce that by more than a factor of 3, and then it takes, yeah, say just a day, just a working day, and not 1.5 full days. How can we do that? Well, the idea is to do as much work as possible in a single path. Pass, and in particular, we can do merging together of sorted sequences. We can handle more than one sequence at once, right? So here's a multi-way merging routine that's, in a sense, a relatively simple generalization of the binary merging algorithm we saw before. Now we have k input sequences, a1 to ak, still a single output sequence. We initialize xi to be the first element of each sequence. And now we do a number of iterations that corresponds to the sum of the input sizes. And now in each iteration, we have to choose the sequence whose current element xi is the smallest one. And then we write that element and read the next element of that sequence. Now here's a case where we should have a close look at the internal work involved, because a naive implementation of this will require time order k, So I ask you as a small exercise, how should you do, can you do that in time order log k? So let's analyze that algorithm. So merging takes time. So you read all the data, you write all the data. So that's basically as before. So the overall number of IOs is 2 times sum of the input length divided by b. In order for this to work, we need space enough for k+1 buffer blocks. That means that we are limited to set k to at most m over b. In order to simplify calculation, I will simply set k less than m over b for in the following. I will also assume that there's enough memory to store the program, etc., just to simplify notation. So overall, we take the run formation as before, takes 2n over b IOs, but now we merge m over b runs at a time. So that has the same cost as binary merging, but the effect is that we are more quickly reducing the number of runs, and it's relatively easy to see that now we have log base m over b n over m runs and rounded up. So the change is in the base of the logarithm, and one can see using logarithm laws basically that this is a factor log m over b smaller than the base 2 logarithm. And well, m over b can well be a few thousands, say, so that we have something like a factor of 10 that we can save here. So overall, the number of IOs we get is 2n over b times 1 plus log base m over b n over m rounded up. So that's an ugly formula. And interestingly, it will show up again and again if you look at other external memory algorithms. Even if they do not use sorting as a subroutine, it seems to be a quite fundamental bound that's showing up in things that you want to do in an IO efficient way. So here's again a picture for the same example. And now instead of the two-way merging phases, we have a single four-way merging phase. So let's also have a look at the internal work. So let's look at the number of comparisons needed to do run formation. That's log m comparisons for each element. You do that with all the input elements, so it's n log m. For multi-way merging, you need log m over b comparisons, roughly. And the number of phases you have is log base m over b n over m. Right? Interestingly, ignoring the constant factors here, setting all of them to 1, and ignoring the rounding thing here also, there's a lot of stuff canceling out. In particular, I said log base m over b n over m is something like log n over m divided by log m over b. So basically, the m over b here and the log m over b here are canceling out, and we get n log n over m. And n log m plus n log n over m is simply n log n. So in a sense, in this algorithm, we're doing about the same number of comparisons as in an internal memory binary merge sort, for example. At least if we do these things efficiently. So yeah, we have this complicated formula. In many cases, actually in practice, this is simply a 2. Because the base of the logarithm is pretty large, right? I told you usually something like a few thousands. Then how can it be that log base m over b, n over m is larger than 1? That can only be the case if n over m is larger than m over b. Yes. But for that to be the case, I said this is a couple of thousand, right? So the input size has to be many thousand times larger than the internal memory. But does that make any sense at all? I claim not, at least if you are talking about the memory hierarchy, main memory and hard disk, and it's even more true for the memory hierarchy, solid state disk and main memory. Because if we use a machine that is has a reasonable configuration, we will spend a similar amount of money on the main memory and on the external memory. But if you look at the price ratio between 1 bit of random access memory and 1 bit of disk memory, this has been for a long time something around 1 or 200. Whereas this for a long time has been larger than 1000. So it never really happens that you need more than one merging pass. I mean, there may be other situations where we use more complex algorithms that have additional constraints, or you might look at different levels of the memory hierarchy. For example, a processor might have a very small level one cache because it has to be very close to the processing unit in order to have low latency, and then you can't make it really large. And then the ratio between, say, the L1 cache size and the main memory size, if that's the two levels of the hierarchy you are considering, might be much larger than 1000. For example, we have an actually moderately priced machine in our working group that has a terabyte of memory. And I think the L1 caches of that machine have 32 kilobytes. So that's a ratio of much more than a million, right? And then you have to be careful. So what else is known on external sorting? Actually, there's a matching lower bound, more or less. Agarwal and Witter have shown in 1988 that the number of IOs you need to sort n elements is the same bound, basically, except for the constant factor. I mean, that's still an open problem. What they have proven, I think, is that you need to perform this number of read operations. And one can somehow assume that you need a matching number of write operations. However, one shouldn't be too sure about these things, because maybe another nice exercise is think about a sorting algorithm that takes only n over m write operations, regardless of only n over b write operations, regardless of how large n is or how large n over m is. One can also look at the generalization of the external memory model with an additional parameter d for the number of disks that are operated in parallel. So now in one I/O step, we can access d blocks at once, but we have to access one block from each disk. And then one would like to have the d basically down here, so everything gets a factor of d faster. And it turned out to be surprisingly difficult to get such an algorithm. It's actually a randomized algorithm where one achieves this in expectation. What's still an open problem is how good we can get a deterministic parallel disk sorting algorithm. There have been several attempts at getting even close to 2n, but one is still quite far away from it. So let's now go to a more general problem, somehow following the blueprint of my textbook, right? Where we say, oh, after sorting, let's look at a generalization where we look at priority queues. If you use an ordinary binary heap priority queue, this is quite bad from the point of view of an external memory algorithm, because you need something like log n over m IOs for each delete min operation. And what we would like to have actually is a factor 1 over b less, and also have the base of the logarithm to be an m over b. So the reason why we would like to have this bound is that then if you are running a priority queue as a sorting algorithm, so you insert n elements and then you do a delete min and output the result, then you get back the bound for sorting. So one would hope that a good IO efficient priority queue can therefore achieve this bound. But of course, that looks like a big step, right? The factor of 1 over b could be huge, a million or so, and this could be another factor of 10. So I will not solve in this lecture the full thing, but I look at a special case, somehow adopting this view that merge sort will never need more than a single multi-way merging path. And the analogon for priority queue is a queue that I call a medium-sized priority queue, where you have something like m square over b as a maximum size of the data structure, or more concretely in this data structure, it's not the size, but the number of insertion operations that you are ever performing, right? And concretely, we have a parameter k that must be less than m over b here. And you have a parameter little m that must be smaller than capital M. And then this mid-sized priority queue looks like this. It has an insertion buffer of size little m that fits an internal memory. It stores most of its element in the form of sorted sequences. There are k of them. And the up to b smallest elements of each sequence are stored in a buffer block. Say, we have a file that's reading from these things, right? And we have a k-way merger data structure, which basically is a priority. So to see how this works, initially all these sequences are empty, the insertion buffer is empty, and this merger is initialized with some dummy values. And an insert initially inserts into the insertion buffer. When this buffer overflows, so it gets size m plus 1, we sort it and flush it as a new sequence somewhere here. And but we keep the smallest elements in this buffer block and insert the smallest key into this merger data structure. Delete min now has to look at two places. Namely, it's either in the insertion buffer or in the merger priority queue. And it returns the smallest of these. And if it's in the merger priority queue, that means it has to fetch the next element from the sequence where the smallest element came from, which could mean that if the buffer block gets empty, it has to fetch the next buffer block. So let's analyze that algorithm. So about the delete min, it's very easy. I mean, it will eventually read every element once from disk. The only exception is that some elements may be directly removed from the insertion buffer. And then I save on some IO, because these elements were also never written out, right? But overall, each element will be read together with B others, so the amortized cost for delete min is 1 over B in this mid-size. And similarly, each element is written at most once as a consequence of an overflow of the insertion buffer, but we will pay M over B IOs for flushing the sorted insertion buffer, but that can be amortized over M elements, so overall it's amortized cost of 1 over B for an insert. So overall it's a cost of 2 over B IOs in an amortized sense for each operation. The internal work is also quite efficient because a delete min basically has to do one comparison to compare these two minima, and depending from which of the two priority queue it deletes, it will be log k or log m comparisons. So this will be larger, right, because that's just m over b and this is m. So, and similarly for the insert operation, we need maybe something like log m operations for an insert, but on average that's just constant. But we need something like m log m comparisons for sorting this thing when flushing it. So overall it's a small constant factor times m log m comparisons for every m operation. So in amortized sense, it's also log m internal cost. So, and at least from a theoretical point of view, we may want to generalize this. And that actually I did in a 1999 paper. And here we have actually a situation where the two-level may not always work if you want to apply it to the cache hierarchy of a real-world machine. And then you get actually a relatively complicated data structure where the mid-sized queue that we have seen is you find again here, plus you have this insertion buffer. But what we do here in the generalized thing is we introduce additional level of the data structure and additional groups of sorted sequences. It's each time k sorted sequences, because the number of sequences that we can efficiently merge is bounded by the main memory size, right? But what we are doing here basically is that we are increasing the size of the sorted sequences by a factor of k whenever we go to a larger group. And basically how this is done is that when this group here overflows, we merge everything together and get one sorted sequence that's a factor of k longer, basically. And in order to get this overall efficient, we need additional group buffers. And we have to be careful about which of these buffers and mergers and buffer blocks we keep in fast memory and which ones can be swapped in and out. That's all fairly complicated. And for details, I refer you to my lecture on algorithm engineering that will be held once more next semester. So, but this has also been implemented, the complicated thing, I mean. So let's look at a number of experiments. This is kind of interesting. It's a long time experience because I wrote this 20 years ago, more than 20 years now. But I have run it again and again on the machines I have. And it turned out that the tuning parameters I used initially still seem to be reasonably good. Right. So that's an experiment with 32-bit random integer keys and 32-bit associated information. We have a deletion buffer of size 32 elements here. The group buffers have 256 elements, and we have a merging degree of k equals 128. And of course, you use a highly optimizing compiler. It's written in C++, and we use a somewhat strange sequence of operations. In the first half of the operations, we insert an element, we delete. The minimum, we insert an element. Insertions are always random integers. They repeat that capital N times, then we have a queue of size capital N, and then we destruct the data structure again by now turning things around. Now in each of these little cycles, we delete an element, insert an element, delete an element, and that N times. So let's look at one of the old measurements. So on the x-axis, you see the input size. On the y-axis, you see the time in nanoseconds for the two operations normalized by log n, because you would expect that an internal queue has cost something like log n. And so that you would basically expect in a von Neumann machine on a binary heap to see a horizontal line here. If you look what actually happens, the circles here are the binary heap. Yes, you have this horizontal line, but then once things go out of the cache size, it goes up linearly. In a logarithmic scale, that's natural because the logarithm in a semi-logarithmic plot will become a linear function, right? Then a previous paper claimed that it's a great advantage if you instead use a heap with out-degree 4. Yes, it's a little bit faster, but this sequence heap data structure that I explained just now actually is much faster than both of these algorithms. It's like a factor of 3 or so. Then you could say, yeah, it's an old machine. What happens now? Here's a relatively new machine. The same thing, right? The binary heap has strange behavior here for small inputs, but then it's flat and goes up linearly. Whereas this goes down, and then at the end we have here something like 2.5 nanoseconds per comparison, and this is 10, so it's a factor of 4. Which is incidentally, this was a factor of 3, now it's a factor of 4. And the other difference, of course, is this went up to 2 to the 23, which is now here, which is basically almost in cache. That was a large input size in 1997. So, of course, now we can go to much larger inputs, but then eventually we see very similar effects. And then, of course, also the absolute times, it's here something like 3 nanoseconds, here it's something like 38. So the machine got something like 10 times faster, but the cache hierarchy effects are there as before, and they may have even increased. So actually, the next experiment I should do here is to run this in parallel on all the cores of a machine, because then the memory access operations get even more dominant, in particular on modern multi-core processors. Still, I think there's some work that one can still do here. One could look for even faster cache-efficient priority queues. For example, for sorting, I told you that multi-way distribution is a bit faster than multi-way merging. Indeed, for internal memory sorting, there is evidence that this may be even a factor of 2 or 3. Can we translate this to priority queues also, maybe by using a distribution-based approach? So there's actually currently a master thesis looking at this, and I'm not sure what we'll get out of it, but it's a quite interesting topic. So to conclude our chapter on external memory algorithms, let's at least choose one graph algorithm. I mean, implementing graph problems in external memory is not so difficult because graphs can have a very chaotic structure, right? Which makes it very difficult to have the locality and memory accesses that you need to get an I/O efficient algorithm. But at least for the minimum spanning tree problem, we can get quite efficient external algorithms. And here I want to explain in detail only a relatively simple thing with some limitations. It's a so-called semi-external algorithm, which means that we assume that the internal memory size is big enough to store a constant number of machine words for each node, or in other words, M is omega N. Capital M, the fast memory size, must be omega N. So that means that this can only handle significantly larger graphs than an internal memory algorithm if the inputs are reasonably dense. If you have very sparse graphs with a constant number of edges per node, then semi-external doesn't give us a lot. But there are quite a number of important graphs where the average degree is fairly large, so it can be kind of useful. And it turns out that semi-external algorithms are sometimes much easier to find than fully external ones. So we will implement Kruskal's algorithm because for this it's we almost know already how it's done, because it's more or less trivial to implement Kruskal's algorithm in an external memory fashion, because how does Kruskal's algorithm work, right? You sort the edges by their weight, increasing weight. So here it says decreasing weight because we are then running over this array in a backward way, but it's not so crucial. So anyway, you sort the edges, and then you iterate through the edges in order of ascending weight, right? And then you need a data structure that tells you whether the two endpoints of an edge are in the same component with respect to the edges that you have already seen. And there's a data structure that does this. It's called the union find data structure. This is this variable TC here. They basically can find a representative for each component. You do that for both endpoints, and if the representatives are different, this means that the edge connects two of the components, and in algorithms one, we have seen that in this case, the edge must be an MST edge. We can output it, and we need some bookkeeping here, namely we now have to put together these two components in the union find data structure, executing this union operation. So yes, and it's semi-external because basically what we need in internal memory is an input buffer, an output buffer, and mainly this union find data structure, which basically needs a constant number of machine words for each node of the graph. Actually, in algorithm engineering lecture, we will see an implementation that needs basically one machine word for each node. And here the constant factors may be important because that means that, for example, on the 1 terabyte machine we have in our working group, we can work on any graphs that has up to now we need more than 4 bytes per node, right? Say 5 bytes per node. So it's something like 200 billion nodes, which is really, really big, right? Okay. So actually, MSTs we can even find in a fully external algorithm. So the idea is to run an algorithm that reduces the number of nodes, and it does it by successively finding MST edges and contracting them, meaning that you identify the two endpoints of an edge, and thus you get rid of one of the nodes. The edges from the deleted node you relink. And that you can do until the graph is small enough with respect to the number of nodes to run the semi-external algorithm. And we have actually also implemented that. But again, for the details, I refer to the algorithm engineering lecture. So here are measurements, actually pretty old ones again, so now we would do that easily in internal memory. But at that time, it was kind of the first experimental study of graph algorithms that worked on really large inputs with billions of edges. What we see here is on the x-axis a linear scale for the number of edges in millions. And the y-axis shows the time per edge in microseconds. We are comparing actually quite a number of things here. So these two lines are the running time for Kruskal's algorithm and the Jarnik Prim algorithm running in internal memory. That's why they end here, basically. What we have here are very sparse random graphs where we have two edges per node. At least that's these star things. And I think for the internal ones, it doesn't matter which input you take, they are rather oblivious to that. And what I just told you, these stars give us the random graph, and then there are two other graph families with the same number of edges, namely a simple grid graph with random edge weights and a random geometric graph where you have random points in the plane and you connect some neighboring nodes. But what's most interesting here, I think, is let's look at this random graph thing first, right? So here are fairly large inputs that on this old machine couldn't be handled on an internal by an internal memory algorithm. And the running time for Kruskal is here, right? And here, these first three inputs are the semi-external Kruskal. And we see that it's just about a factor of two slower. I think it also uses several disks in parallel, so the I/O overhead is somewhat limited. So we see that running Kruskal's algorithm in the semi-external setting is not much slower than running it in internal memory. That's good news. And then when it gets beyond the scale where you can handle it by the semi-external algorithm, the fully external thing kicks in. It increases the running time, but it's not an astronomical increase. If you would do a naive implementation with random disk accesses for each edge or so, you would have an explosion in the running time by several orders of magnitude. An interesting effect here is that, well, this curve here basically follows the prediction of the theoretical worst case analysis. But interestingly, these geometric and grid graphs, they are much easier to handle than the random graph. This is because when you run the node reduction algorithm on this algorithm, you not only get rid of nodes, but you also get rid of a lot of edges that get parallel. So the graph remains sparse despite node contractions, whereas in a random graph, if you reduce the number of nodes, the number of edges is not significantly reduced, and so cost goes up. So that brings us to the end of the chapter on external memory algorithms. So what more is known on external memory algorithms? Of course, that's an entire subdiscipline of algorithmics. But let's look at the basic toolbox of things that you have learned in algorithms one, right? So hash tables, of course, you can run them on external memory. And that's also done in some applications. But you have to be aware that you need at least one I/O per access, which is orders of magnitude slower than a main memory access, because basically you need one element, you get B for free, even if you don't want them, right? But implementing this is not so difficult. Even linear probing hash table will work fairly well. Search trees. Actually, what we presented in algorithms one, the AB trees, they are already used as an external memory algorithm since their invention. because they are fairly I/O efficient. The number of I/Os you need is log base b of n number of I/Os. And it turns out that these AB trees, as they are also called, kind of the bread and butter data structure for classical databases, in particular as an index data structure, but now they are also used in file systems and so on. There's also a lot of tuning stuff that you may want to do if you need use it as an external memory algorithm. You want to cache the nodes near the root, which then basically means that you will have only one or two levels of the tree in external memory in many practical situations. And it turns out that you may want to have much larger leaves than the internal nodes, because then you can achieve higher bandwidths for scanning entire ranges of elements, which is a frequent operation, particularly in databases. So as I already said, graph algorithms are kind of more difficult. But at least breadth-first search we can do reasonably well, particularly if you're looking at graphs of low diameter. Because then basically we can afford to scan the entire graph for each iteration or large parts of the graph. But depth-first search is even more difficult because it jumps around in a complicated way through the graph. There are some reasonable heuristics for doing DFS in a semi-external case. And shortest path is kind of a bit similar to BFS, but maybe more difficult depending on how the edge weights are distributed. So thank you very much.